Vitousek graduated from Amherst College in 1971 and received his PhD in Biological Sciences from Dartmouth College. He is now the Clifford G. Morrison Professor of Population and Resource Studies at Stanford University and the Director of the INMET Interdisciplinary Program in Environment and Resources. Dr. Peter Vitousek has been named America's Best Ecologist by Time Magazine thanks to his work on how cycling of nitrogen is impacted by human activity. He has found that the consumption of fossil fuels and fertilizers leads to detrimental impacts on the environment, ranging from the pollution of rivers and coastal areas to the reduction in biodiversity. In addition to being a prolific researcher, Dr. Vitousek has been heavily engaged in outreach, particularly in his native Hawaii, where he is the co-director of the First Nations Future Program. A fellow of the National Academy of Sciences and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, he has been recognized multiple times for his work by the Ecological Society of America. Dr. Vitousek has authored over 300 publications, 8 of which were published in Nature and 13 in Science. In 2010, he was awarded the Japan Prize, granted to those whose original and outstanding achievements in science and technology are recognized as having advanced the frontiers of knowledge. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Peter Vitousek, Pacific Islands as Model Systems for Human-Environment Interactions.
Well, thank you, Danny. Thank all of you for being here. And I want to particularly thank the organizing committee, which I know includes them, for their extraordinary organization, willingness to go the extra mile, and enthusiasm for this symposium. It's really impressive and a little intimidating. And all I can say is that I hope to pay them back at the student symposium tomorrow. So, but that's all I can offer. And it's a small thing compared to what I think it is that they've provided. Now, I'm going to take us from Ecuador, where we were in the first talk, to the southwest of the U.S. in the second talk to Hawaii, and can't stay here. We're going to go on this afternoon, and I'm going to talk about oceanic islands as model systems for understanding ecosystems and human-environment interactions that can lead to sustainability. Now, you know, by talking about model systems, I mean something reasonably specific. I've looked around at how people have used the term model system, and I think there are at least two senses in which the term is used. One, which has been with us for a long time, suggests here in a quote from a 1929 paper, for a large number of problems, there'll be some animal of choice or a few such animals on which it can most conveniently be studied. Needless to say, this person was an animal physiologist. But you notice here the emphasis is on the problem, the scientific challenge, and the animal, the model system, makes it convenient to study the fundamental process of interest. This other sense comes from a discussion of the nematode C. elegans, which, as this suggests, provides the researcher with an ideal compromise between complexity and tractability, complex enough to be real and interesting, simple enough to be tractable. And I'm going to suggest that islands offer us this way to use a model system in both of these dimensions. And I'll illustrate both of these dimensions here, both for ecosystems and for understanding human-environment interactions. Okay, I think islands are useful as models in a number of dimensions, ranging at least from evolution and the origin of species to the dynamics of ecosystems, to the development and sustainability of human societies. The first of these has been appreciated, at least since Darwin, after visiting the Galapagos, wrote about here feeling near, both in space and time, to that great fact, that mystery of mysteries, the first appearance of new beings on the earth. And you know, this was really important, remains really important for evolutionary biologists now. I'm not going to talk about that. I'm going to move on to the second, formation, structure, and dynamics of soils and ecosystems, where I've spent most of my work over the last few decades working in Pacific Islands. And for ecosystems, There are a number of reasons why Hawaii, where I've particularly concentrated my work, is a useful system. Some have to do with complexity and tractability. That is, the islands are relatively simple in some important ways. Some of the major controlling factors don't vary, or don't vary very much, across an extremely broad range of conditions. It's all basalt parent material, all basalt rock from the Hawaiian hotspot. There's volcanic topography. As you can see here, this is Mauna Loa volcano, where the famous carbon dioxide record comes from. 13,700 feet tall, and there's no topography there to speak of. And you can find situations like that on all the islands of any age. At the same time, there's a lot of variability that's really interesting. There are well-defined substrate ages, from hot rock to ancient soils in the far northwest of the Hawaiian archipelago. There are spectacular rainfall gradients, where rainfall varies as much as 20-fold over a linear distance of 15 kilometers, which is pretty good rainfall gradient, and while holding all these other things constant. At the same time, there are some special features that make it interesting for study. One is that you can trace the different sources of nutrients, of elements, that support plant productivity or soil fertility in the long run. The Hawaiian basalt is derived from Earth's mantle. Yeah, you can trace weathering of the basalt, that breakdown of the parent rock, using ratios of elements to niobium. And there's an isotopic signature that's different from that of the ocean, where marine aerosol provides some of the nutrients, and different again from continental crust, because there's long distance transport of dust, I'm using that dirty word again, from the Asian continent particularly to the Hawaiian archipelago. And by the way, I won't talk about this much, it's gotten dustier in Hawaii now because of land use change in China, but this is nothing compared to how dusty it was in the full glacial, when there were glaciers grinding up rock and there was no vegetation in front of those glaciers. That's when most of the dust came into Hawaii. And so we can trace these things and understand how they vary in space and time. And in doing that work over the years, we can put together a fairly good summary of the sources of nutrients that sustain ecosystems. We can show that in young or dry soils, most of the nutrients that forests, I focus on forests, need come from the breakdown of the basaltic rock that is the parent rock of Hawaii. But where it's wet, basalt is depleted of most of its nutrients in a few tens of thousands of years. And thereafter, most nutrients, but not phosphorus, are deposited by rain or cloud water and derived ultimately from the ocean that surrounds Hawaii. Phosphorus from the lava rock lasts longer, which is a good thing because there isn't much of it in marine aerosol at all. There's not much in the surface ocean. But in wet sites, once you get out to soils, to substrates that are a million plus years old, most of the phosphorus too is gone. And thereafter, the dust blown in from Central Asia, mostly during the full glacial periods, is what supplies the main input of phosphorus to these systems. Now the wonderful thing in Hawaii is we can trace all of these isotopically. We can measure soils and get their flavor. You know, this is 10% basalt, 60% marine aerosol, and 30% dust is something we can actually measure in these systems. But what makes this a useful model system is that these are general processes. The rates of input of all these different things are, of course, place dependent. But the importance of processes and the dynamics of those processes is a general phenomenon. And so to copy a slide that was also showed in the last talk, this is a dust storm on its way off the Sahara on its way to North America. And in fact, the northern Amazon gets far more dust from the Sahara than Hawaii does from the Gobi Desert and from Central Asian deserts more generally. And it's a general feature of lowland rainforests on ancient soils that their phosphorus economy is controlled by long distance transport of dust from arid and semi-arid ecosystems, often long ago in the past. The advantage in the Hawaiian system is we can trace that, but once we've identified and traced it, we can apply that process more broadly. Another interesting sort of general feature that we observe from this is that soils properties don't vary gradually along continuous gradients in environmental forcing. This is a illustration where in blue I'm showing base cations along a rainfall gradient in Hawaii. I'll come back to this rainfall gradient. And you can see that they are high up to a point, they go through a very sharp transition, a threshold, and are very low thereafter. We can also see by measuring rates of basalt weathering that in the underlying soil using strontium isotopes, that the breakdown of that underlying basalt increases more or less linearly as a function of increasing rainfall up to the point where that basalt, the primary minerals in that basalt, are exhausted. They're gone. And so of course they can't break down and release any more nutrients. And what this transition essentially represents is the transition from rock as the main source of nutrients to rain as the main source of nutrients. But it happens as a threshold. And that's the important thing. A lot of the transitions we see on continuous gradients are threshold type transitions, not sort of gradual changes in soil properties with a gradual change in forcing. Generalizing some from that, we see pedogenic thresholds as occurring where there's a rapid and or non-linear change in soil properties along a continuous gradient of environmental forcing. We also recognize what we call process domains in the areas between thresholds. Because of course, if a lot of change happens in narrow areas along continuous gradients, there are broad areas where not much is happening, where not much is changing on those same continuous gradients. And we consider those to be soil process domains. And these are quite general on gradients of rainfall that we've studied or on gradients of substrate age that we've studied. To evaluate these further and to understand the dynamics of an ancient traditional Polynesian agricultural system that I'll talk about later, we sampled hundreds of soils across the same rainfall gradient that was shown in this slide and found properties illustrated here. I'm just illustrating for a really conservative soil property, the ratio of total aluminum to total iron in the soil, and for a much more dynamics property, exchangeable calcium in the soil. And you can see that there are distinct regions along the gradient. We identify a threshold where this reflects biological uplift, plants lifting nutrients from deep in the soil and depositing them on the surface, plus ongoing breakdown of basaltic rock. This point here, I'm marked as uplift detectable here, and this point here I mark as mineral depletion, when the soil is depleted of rock-derived nutrients. And so there are a couple of clear thresholds that demarcate three domains. One, a dryland domain where wind erosion is important. Another domain of very low fertility soils that are enriched in iron. And a third domain of ongoing weathering and biological uplift of nutrients for which we see that most of the important plant nutrients are highly enriched. This is the rainfall gradient here. This is the resin phosphorus concentrations in white, the exchangeable calcium in red, and net nitrogen mineralization in white. All of these show a very sharp, distinct peak in nutrient availability in that domain of ongoing weathering and biological uplift of nutrients. And you know, this is something that we see in soils. Not surprisingly, we also see it in organisms. This is a ordination of the bacterial and archaeal communities based on 16S sequencing of fungi based on ITS. And the darkest dots are the wettest sites, the lightest dots are the driest sites. You see for both bacteria, archaea, and for fungi, the first axis of ordination correlates beautifully with the underlying rainfall gradient. The second axis correlates with the soil fertility axis, with that domain of biological uplift and ongoing weathering. And so it's something that we see reflected in biological communities. Now I'm going to leave ecosystems for a while and move on to talk a bit about the development and sustainability of human societies. As I'm sure you can see, there are places I can come back and make a connection. And you know, the idea that Pacific Islands are particularly useful for understanding the development of human societies, their sustainability, for human-land interactions, for cultural evolution in general, is something that's been around and well recognized by anthropologists. This is an extended quote by my Berkeley colleague, Patrick Kirch, who's worked in the Pacific for many years, and I won't read it all because it embarrasses me because he writes so much better than I do, but that's a problem. I can't get around. I'll just end by saying it's not only the range of environmental variation among isolated Pacific islands, but also the demonstrable fact that many societies had common origins that renders them such marvelous microcosms, such wonderful natural and cultural experiments of history. The model system is a pale shadow of that, right? But it means the same thing. Okay. So who is Kirch talking about? Well, he's talking about the Polynesian people who, between about 2000 and about 800 years ago, sailed in double-hulled sailing canoes on deliberate voyages of exploration and colonization throughout the Pacific, carrying with them their plants that they needed economically, including timber plants in some cases, and carrying with them their domestic animals, and carrying with them their ideas for how land should be used and society should be organized. They covered an extraordinarily wide range of the Pacific in a short period of time, reaching the extremity of their successful colonizations, at least, in Hawaii, in New Zealand, and on Easter Island, an area that's much larger, an area of ocean that's much larger than the land area of the United States. Sailing on these double-hulled sailing canoes and establishing their societies where they discovered habitable lands. But the interesting thing about this, from the perspective of cultural evolution and human-land interactions, is the islands that they discovered were, in some cases, really different, and in some cases, pretty similar. To illustrate the difference, I can show Hawaii, which is a reasonably large archipelago, about 16,000 kilometers squared, with a lot of relatively rich soils. They also found atolls, like those in the Tuamotus, which are tiny specks of coral-derived sand where they established societies. They found Rapa Nui, or Easter Island, which is 1/100th the size of Hawaii and has no really fertile soils comparable to the richer soils in Hawaii. They found Aotearoa, or New Zealand, a subcontinental landmass 20 times the size of Hawaii, where on the South Island, so did half of the South Island, none of the crops they carried with them would grow. Zero. So they faced really different situations in these really different environments. And yet they established societies, and those societies evolved over time in interaction with the land that they had found. And in doing so, they provide a really remarkable model for human societies for a lot of reasons. There's the common origins of the people, carrying with them plants, animals, and ideas. They landed on well-characterized and highly distinct lands, and they did so relatively recently. So the elements of the process are still accessible to us. The places they discovered were relatively isolated. Not completely, although Hawaii ended up completely isolated from the rest of Polynesia hundreds of years before European contact. But still more so than continental societies ever were isolated. And so internal dynamics were more important than interactions or relatively so compared to continents at least, in shaping the developments of societies. Another important feature is the Polynesians were a really dynamic and innovative society that diverged in land use and social structure, and that, at least in Hawaii, evolved into highly complex and both socially and culturally highly complex societies that some anthropologists recognize as nations. Finally and crucially, they're also living cultures that wish to contribute to the process of discovery themselves and participate in the process. Now, I've talked about this in terms of a model system. Some of my Hawaiian colleagues don't think in terms of model systems. How can our home be a model? But they do think in terms of the question, when did Hawaiians become Hawaiian? At what point did the Hawaiian people become the Hawaiian people? And their answer is one that I recognize as very, very accessible to analysis in a comparative cultural sense. It's when their culture diversified from that of the original people who colonized Hawaii because of their interactions with the land of Hawaii. That's when native New Zealanders, the Maori, became Maori. That's when native people of Rapa Nui became Rapa Nuian. That's when Hawaiians became Hawaiian, when their interactions with the land differentiated their culture from that of the people who actually made the discovery. Now, this is interesting, but of course, this isn't me. I'm an ecologist, I'm not really involved in cultural evolution per se. What I'm interested in is human-land interaction. And for that, Polynesian islands offer great opportunities as well. This is particularly true when you look at agriculture. And I'm going to focus on agriculture because I think agriculture is a crucial, and perhaps the most crucial, nexus between ecosystems and human societies. Because features of both the society, as we've just talked about, and the land, as I talked about stressing ecosystems, make agricultural intensification more accessible to understanding in Polynesia than elsewhere. Also, the Hawaiians in particular were really good farmers. They intensified agriculture by multiple pathways across the very different landscapes of Hawaii and developed sustained systems that persisted for hundreds of years through the early phases of European contact. The most significant contrast in their agricultural systems was between irrigated wetland cultivation in taro pond fields versus rainfed dryland agriculture of sweet potato, particularly. And as I'll talk about, the mode of agricultural production shaped in part the development of the society in Hawaii and elsewhere. And it's that process that I'm interested in, that interaction between humans and the dynamics of agricultural intensification. Contrast between irrigated and rain-fed systems was mapped more than 20 years ago by my colleague Pat Kirch again. Here he showed an idea of the major zones of dryland cultivation of rain-fed agriculture for sweet potato particularly versus of pond field irrigation for taro in particular. You note that the islands are arrayed in order of age here with the young island of Hawaii to the southeast and the old island of Kauai to the northwest. You also note that rain-fed dryland systems are dominant on the young island of Hawaii, and irrigated systems are dominant on the older islands to the northwest. And I was interested in understanding the distribution dynamics and reasons for existence of this distribution of intensive agricultural systems across the archipelago. Only after I began the work did I learn that this map actually resulted from a drawing on a cocktail napkin at an American Archaeological Society meeting. There are no data that underlie this, although Kirch does know his way around the Hawaiian Islands, and as I'll show, there's a lot to this map. So when we started working on this, I focused initially on the Kohala volcano on the north end of the island of Hawaii. If you've been to Hawaii, this is Waipio Valley here. This is the, there's a series of very high-end resorts on this coast. You won't have to ask which is wet and which is dry, because this is actually irrigated pond fields, and high-end resorts means it doesn't rain very much. Right? And this system is really cool for a lot of reasons, because it has a really incredible rainfall gradient across this volcano. It rains about 3,500 millimeters a year, sorry, 4,500 millimeters a year in this area, about 180 inches of rain a year. It rains about 180 millimeters, or about 7 inches here. The distance between those is only 17 kilometers. So it's a really striking rainfall gradient, and gradient in soil properties, and gradient in ecosystems in a small area. Also, Kohala supported, this mountain supported in the deep valleys here on the windward northeast side, the most extensive irrigated systems on the island of Hawaii, on the young island of Hawaii. This is the oldest part of the youngest island, and it does have streams and valleys that can support the development of irrigated agriculture. These irrigated systems persisted through the disruptions of colonization, the devastation brought by introduced disease, which killed 90% of Native Hawaiians in the first 50 years or so following European contact, and have maintained some social and cultural continuity to the present. So we can learn about these systems. There's real knowledge about the ongoing practices in these systems. They've evolved, of course, but they're available for study, and they're now actually being restored quite extensively. Kohala on the leeward side also supported a really remarkable rain-fed field system. This is, of course, ranch land here. The walls running across the slope, the oceans down here, mountains up here, the lines running across the slope are field walls from that dryland field systems. And there was more than a 60 kilometer squared area on this leeward slope that was covered with these, and they had a very dense network of field walls and paved trails that was one of the important rainfed dryland systems in the archipelago. And this is a LIDAR image of a small portion of that same field system, which gives you a good idea of just how intensive it was. We'll note from this, this is not home gardens. This is not a shifting cultivation system. This is an intensive agricultural system. And it has more in common with the role of Iowa in the United States than it does with a home garden sort of system. It was a place where agriculture was intensified and a surplus was produced that fed the development of a complex society where people could play social roles other than that of farming. But with the depopulation of the native population of Hawaii, with the disruptions of colonization, these systems were abandoned in the mid-19th century, and they've been lost both to memory and practice. If you ask most people in Hawaii, they don't know that these things ever existed, much less how extensive they were and what role they played in Hawaiian society. So, I was involved in trying to understand how these things work. And not surprisingly, I suspected with colleagues that the location of these rain-fed systems was related to the thresholds and soil properties I showed before, in particular that domain of high levels of nutrient availability. And in fact, we sampled soils extensively across this. This is a complex map of Kohala. What it shows, though, simply is rainfall isohyets in the cyan color, two different ages of substrates in the blue and the brown here, elevation contours in the thin black lines, and then this area of intensive agriculture in tan here. And then the red dots are all the places we sampled soils. And we were just trying to, actually we did this to understand the distribution of the agricultural system first and developed our understanding and mapping of thresholds and domains out of the samples that we collected for characterizing the agricultural systems. But all the red dots were places we collected and analyzed soils. And if we look at the results, it's really pretty clear. Here, the yellow dots are areas inside that rain-fed agricultural system. The white dots are areas outside that agricultural system on Kohala. The red dots are from the much older islands of Molokai and Kauai that are off to the northwest on much older landscapes. What I've plotted here is just exchangeable calcium, and you can see that the rain-fed agricultural system occupied this domain of ongoing weathering and biological uplift. Its upper margin is defined by the point where soils became too infertile for sustained intensive agriculture. The lower margin was probably set by where it became too dry for it. Furthermore, if you look at the older substrates in the islands, there's no place. You know, the millions of years of water moving through the soil have leached nutrients out of the soil. There's no place that's both fertile enough for intensive rain-fed agriculture and wet enough for intensive rain-fed agriculture. It makes sense that these rain-fed Hawaiian production systems were, in effect, farming the breakdown of rock. Because, as we know, forests, natural systems more generally, are very conservative with nutrients. They are very good at recycling nutrients. They can maintain productivity by effectively preventing losses of nutrients and using the same nutrient over and over. In contrast, agricultural systems inherently involve the removal of nutrients from production systems that must be replaced And the more intensive and high-yielding the agriculture, the more the nutrients are removed. And so it makes sense that these intensive production systems were located in places where there was a big supply of nutrients from the ongoing breakdown of the rock. Another way of looking at this is saying that these rain-fed agricultural systems essentially occupied a sweet spot of soil fertility. Enough rainfall to support intensive cropping, but not so much that soil fertility had been lost. That sweet spot is the domain of rock weathering and biological uplift, and that sweet spot dwindles and ultimately disappears in progressively older substrates across the Hawaiian archipelago. So, based on these analyses, we did our own cocktail napkin map, although this is actually a GIS-based map, of the distribution of potential rain-fed agricultural systems and, based on topography, rainfall, and stream flow, where irrigated systems could have been developed. And that's shown here again. The youngest island of Hawaii is almost exclusively, not completely, dominated by rain-fed systems. The oldest island of Kauai, almost exclusively dominated by irrigated systems with a spectrum in between. This is based on some data. It also had some interesting features that when we put this together, we sort of looked down here and said, what's with that? There's a right angle in the distribution of a potential field system. And by the way, this is not where the cocktail napkin had this field system developing. And so we went to the original, we were sitting in a conference room, we went to the original source of all information, Google Earth, and looked at this ranch land, and by God, there's the residue of a Hawaiian rain-fed field system there with a right-angle corner. So we feel pretty good about this as representing the distribution of intensive agriculture in the Hawaiian Islands prior to European contact. Then, drawing from literature on traditional agricultural systems elsewhere in the Pacific and some of our own experiments that are ongoing, we put together information contrasting land, labor, and agricultural yield on Hawaii Island, which is the youngest dryland-dominated island in the archipelago, with Kauai, the oldest and rain-fed and irrigated dominated. I should say before I go on that this is also interesting in that we know based on ethnohistorical accounts that in the centuries before European contact, the Hawaiian archipelago had developed what are recognized as fairly well-organized nation-states with hereditary kingship and multiple levels in their political hierarchies, and that these islands, these nations were centered on different islands in the archipelago. So the island of Hawaii was one, the island of Maui and its smaller satellites another, Oahu a third, and Kauai with its satellite of Niihau a fourth. So these are distinct nations. One supported almost entirely by rain-fed agriculture, one supported almost entirely by irrigated agriculture, and the others intermediate. So if we look at this, the area available for intensive agricultural production on the island of Hawaii is much larger than that on the island of Kauai. Almost all of it's rain-fed on Hawaii. Now, irrigated agriculture, not surprisingly, is higher yielding than rain-fed agriculture in these systems. It also requires less labor once the irrigation systems are built. And so if you look at the total yield of food from these, even though there's 10 times as much land on Hawaii Island, there's only between 3 and 4 times as much yield from these intensive systems on Hawaii Island. And producing that yield requires 160,000 person days of labor on Hawaii Island versus only about 8,000 on the island of Kauai. Add to that the fact that the rain-fed systems are also more vulnerable in terms of their response to drought, and periodic droughts clearly affected their productivity. And you can see that there were the amount of surplus available over agricultural labor was much greater on the rain-fed island of Kauai than on the, I'm sorry, the irrigated production systems of the island of Kauai than on the rain-fed systems of the island of Hawaii. The amount of surplus that chiefs could use or that people could use to play roles like priest, like dancer, like warrior in the society was very much greater on the irrigated islands in the archipelago. Another interesting feature is this amount of number of person years of labor is approximately the population of Hawaii Island in 2010, suggesting that these agricultural production systems actually supported larger populations than exist now on all of the islands in the archipelago, except for the island of Oahu, where the city of Honolulu is located. These were systems that were sustained for centuries and that supported extremely highly populated and complex societies. And interestingly, this contrast between the islands explains some other features that are known ethnohistorically. One is that the religious structure of the islands was different in the pre-contact period, with different gods from the Polynesian pantheon being relatively more important in the rain-fed than in the irrigated lands. Another observation is a Hawaiian historian in the peri-contact period writing that men and women worked equally in the fields of Hawaii Island, but only men worked in the fields of the older islands in the archipelago, given the labor requirement of rain-fed agriculture. That makes sense. Another is that there was substantial conflict between the states with wars, raiding, and what are, I'm sure, euphemistically called marriage alliances between the leadership of the different nations that occupied different islands in the couple of hundred years before contact. And the oral history accounts make clear that that conflict was initiated by societies based on the young islands, where the amount of surplus available over the need of agricultural labor was less, but there was a lot of labor, a lot of people. And these dynamics culminated in the conqueror Kamehameha, who unified the archipelago shortly after European contact. He was born in and was a product of this Kohala field system that I was analyzing. And he clearly used European weapons to put Polynesian politics into play and conquered the archipelago and brought it under his own control and leadership, unifying it for the first time in known Hawaiian history. Now, this conflict between irrigated agricultural lands that are highly productive and well-organized and less productive upland systems, maybe rain-fed, sometimes they're grazing systems, is not uniquely Hawaiian, of course. You can all think of examples from Europe, from the Middle East, from China, of places where people from the less productive upland systems raided into and often conquered people of settled and often irrigated lands. But the interesting feature here is it's the same people on both sides of the divide. The time depth is very shallow. People had not been in Hawaii for more than 800 or at most 1,000 years before European contact. And everybody on both sides of the divide had descended from the colonists who came fairly recently to Hawaii. And this pattern of interaction between rain-fed dryland and irrigated lowland is repeated across the Pacific. Okay, I want to just briefly say I'm taking this work now in a number of different directions. One is by trying to analyze production systems and their implications on other contrasting Polynesian islands. So far I've worked some in Rapa Nui, or Easter Island, in Aotearoa, and in Morea, with the ultimate question being where and why did more sustainable production systems develop in some, but not all, Pacific Islands in Polynesia. A second area is I'm really interested in using the gradients of soils and biogeochemistry of rock-derived elements here to understand the regulation of nitrogen cycling and limitation, and the distribution and functioning of microbial communities. You know, I showed before that slide of phosphorus, calcium, and nitrogen availability across a rainfall gradient. Well, phosphorus and calcium you can explain mechanistically very easily. Why is nitrogen just like them? And then the final thing is with Native Hawaiian community partners working to understand how, not just where and with what implications, but how traditional intensive agriculture worked in the many years where it was sustained before European contact. And if possible, carrying that knowledge forward into 21st century agriculture. And I'd be really excited by the possibility that young Hawaiians will connect with the remarkable innovation in agricultural production that's in their past and use it in building a more sustainable production system for the future. So, thank you. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have.